and New Life's Pastor David here. So glad to have you with us for midday. Whether you're at home, whether you're at your office, let's take a moment right now and just welcome the Holy Spirit into our hearts and our minds. Allow His presence to come in afresh. Today we're going to have a time of worship and have some talk with some of our pastors. But right now, let's just take a moment, open up your hands. Let's receive His presence afresh in our hearts and our minds. Lord, we thank You that You're here in this place. We thank You that Your presence fills us, that You give us peace, that You give us Your love. Most of all, thank You for Your word, both Your written word and Your prophetic word that's spoken into our lives. May it fill us today. We say we need You. We say we can't live without You. So fill us, Lord. We right now just begin to say these words. Fill us, Lord. Fill us from the top of our head to the bottom of our feet. Fill us to every broken place. Fill us in our homes. Fill us. We receive You. We receive You today. Let's worship together.
Come and fill up this place, O Lord. We want You here. Come and fill up my heart, O Lord. I want You near. You can fill up this space, O Lord. We want You near. You can fill up my heart, O Lord. I want You here. You're the God in my living. You're there in my breathing. God in my waking. God in my sleeping. You're the God in my resting. You're there in my working. God in my thinking. You're the God in my speaking. You're the God in my living. You're there in my breathing. You're God in my waking. You're the God in my sleeping. Oh, God in my resting. You're there in my working. Oh, God in my thinking. God in my speaking. Be my everything. Be my everything, oh Lord. Yeah, my everything. You are everything. You're God in my hoping. There in my dreaming. God in my watching. You're the God in my waiting. You're the God in my laughing. You're there in my weeping. You're God in my hurting. You're God in my healing. Be my everything. Be my everything. Be my everything. Be my everything. Oh, 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 Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Be my 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 everything. You are my everything, oh Lord. Be involved in my everything. In my everything, you're welcome. And get involved in my every moment, oh Lord. There you're welcome. We welcome you here, Lord. We welcome you near, Lord. You are everything. You are everything. Oh, Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything. Christ in me, Christ in me, Christ in me, the hope of glory. You are everything.
Lord, we ask that you would be our everything. Lord, we say these words so easily with our lips, but I ask that it would be the reality of our lives, that you'd be everything. You'd be more than songs that we sing. You would be more than just doctrine that we declare, but you would be the reality in our lives of that doctrine and of those songs. That you, Jesus, who is the center of your church, would you be the center of our lives? That all things that we are, and all things that we long to be, you, hope of glory in us, would it be so? And we give you permission, Holy Spirit, to speak those words to us that need to realign our hearts to that truth, that you are our everything. So we collectively, as one body, we say, speak now, Spirit of God. We are listening. And may you grant us a grace to say, here we are. Here we are. We will do that which you say. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Jackson. Jackson and Cleanne have been two of our worship leaders that have carried the weight and the brunt of so much of these midday prayers and midday worship times. And I'm just so thankful for the anointed worship team and leaders that we have across our campuses. And of course, Pastor Tina leads that as our pastor of worship. And so, Jackson, thank you for all that you do. Well, welcome to Midday. As if you've been following us for a bit, you know that we have a number of creative ways that these middays look. Sometimes they're more devotional and worship sets, and sometimes they are intercession sets. And we've also chosen about one or two each week to do what we call a pastoral table talk. And that's where we'll take a topic, we'll gather a few of our pastors and directors around a table, and we'll discuss something that we feel like is relevant to the dynamic of prayer and relevant to the dynamic of this response of COVID-19 of the church in our personal lives. And today's topic, saw today will go, is I'll just share a couple thoughts and then we'll dialogue with this together. Family, as you're watching, if there is a nugget that either that something that we say that really strikes your heart, would you comment inside of that, of the feed in here? Maybe there's a question that emerges as we're talking. Feel free to type that question in there, and we're just going to dialogue on this topic and then take some of your questions that are in there as well. As I was praying about what we might share here in this today, at least, I heard the phrase the Lord just kind of whispered to me of what is the role of the prophetic in a time of chaos. And chaos being of what's happening around us currently, so much is upheaved, right? The schools are in a place of upheaval. Governments are in a place of upheaval. Family routines are in a place of upheaval. Finances and businesses. And what's the role of the prophetic to our lives in that time and in that space? And as I have over, I'm sure many of you similarly, I've been intentionally quieting myself, believing that the Lord is speaking a word, and quieting to hear what might he be saying. And I believe in a time of upheaval, in a time of chaos, the prophetic or the word that God is speaking is at a premium. I believe it's finances are important and educational dynamics are important and vaccines are important. But I think when we look at culture and history, when we look at scripture, in these moments of upheaval, what is of the utter preeminence is what is God saying specifically, not to just the church and the nations. That is a need for sure. But as I have been thinking about this, the prophetic, I think, is less about declaring things to nations and declaring things to governments and declaring things on platforms, on microphones and social media feeds. And I think the prophetic ultimately is God's word to our hearts, specifically about us. Now, let me just quickly define prophetic for a moment because I feel like that has gotten both a misused and abused definition in rap of what it actually is. And if you've got your Bibles, take for a minute, just open up to Psalms 139. This is probably my favorite verse to reference what I believe ultimately the prophetic is. David is writing about God's intimate knowledge of us in Psalms 139, and he says this in verse 17. He says, "How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sands of the shore. When I awake, I am still with you." I would simply define the prophetic as this. It's God sharing one of these infinite amount of thoughts that he has about you to you. Simply put, it's He's got right. God the Father is thinking all of these thoughts. God the Son is praying all kinds of those thoughts to God the Father. And the prophetic is simply this, that you get one of those thoughts that he's thinking about you imparted into your heart. A thought about you, yes, about your business, and yes, about your family, but about your sense of emotions, about your spiritual vitality. And I get a sense that what the Lord is primarily speaking in times of chaos is about our own internal heart's response. And I read on my feeds and see so many things that people are looking for a word to declare, and I feel like what the prophetic in a time of chaos it really is, it's a word to adopt. It's a word to germinate. It's a word that the Lord is speaking to you about how are you going to face your fears in a time of chaos. That's not for you to get a new Zoom feed and a new Facebook feed and a new following to declare that, thus saith the Lord, do not fear. No, that prophetic word was meant for your own heart to deal with the internal composition. And then as you germinate with that word in dialogue with the Lord, right, you are asking questions like, why am I fearing? And what are the things that I'm afraid of? And so the prophetic mostly, in my opinion, mostly becomes about God's thoughts about how you are doing in the internal dynamic of your heart. I use this phrase, the internal composition of your heart. The prophetic is less about praying and causing people to fall down, less about praying to be the man of God who said X, Y, Z, and it's mostly about hearing God's thoughts about you and who you are. And I've run in enough church circles that I think, this is not to lob a stone at the American church, but we've developed a culture of prophetic sugar daddies where we are more comfortable in running to somebody else. If you got, you can just hashtag that prophetic sugar daddy. That's a new term that we're gonna coin here. Go ahead and just put that in there. We're more comfortable running to somebody else to get a word about us than we are being willing to carve out 30 minutes to sit down and let Holy Spirit speak to us about us. Now, God will use somebody else because he is that in love with you. He wants you to hear that word to you. But as I have grown in the gift of the prophetic, as I've grown in this, I have found that anything that I ever say to somebody else is out of an overflow of what he's currently saying with me. What he's currently doing in me, that the prophetic is supposed to be an overflow of intimacy with God. You get near him, and then you start hearing what he says. Look what David says in this text. He says, there's all of these thoughts towards me. How great is the sum of them? If I could count them, they would be more than a number of the sand, right? Like he's, it's evident David is hearing some of these thoughts, but this last line in verse 18, I think, is what sums it up. And when I'm awake, I'm with you. Implied that when I've come close to you, you are talking to me. Is it possible that the creator of the universe might have an agenda by which he wants to talk to you, and it probably isn't about your neighbor or your spouse or your kids or your church or the nation? Who his agenda probably is to talk to you about you. So I want to just briefly hit this, and then we'll discuss a couple thoughts. The three things that I have found that the Lord, in my own life, and I look at this biblically, I think this is true. The first thing, the primary role of the prophetic is that he unveils to us what's going on in my heart that I don't even know was there. A couple weeks ago, we did this with Pastor David and or Pastor Jeremy and Cleanne. I'm a dreamer. I dream often. And what I have found is the dreams that God gives me have very little to do with the future and mostly something to do with my own heart, my own fears, my own insecurities, my own anger, my own frustrations, places of discipleship that he's working on, and that I didn't know it. And it took a dream. It took a prophetic word to tell me what's going on in me. And you've got to be willing and open. When I hear people say that God doesn't speak to them, I oftentimes think this. No, he probably does. It may just be that you're unwilling to listen to his conversation. Because 80% of his conversation is probably about how you are maturing and how you're doing in the part of your heart. And if I'm unwilling to hear that, then I ain't going to hear it. And I'm going to miss 80% of what Jesus has to say. And so the prophetic I have found is mostly about what's going on inside of our heart. And in a time of chaos, this is what's at premium, is can you hear him speak to you? And then he will talk about a past season, and he will talk about a future thing that he's wanting to do. But I think additionally, that is only about us being able to then have a heart prepared for what he's saying. So if he says, I'm going to do this in the church, I'm going to do this as it relates to COVID-19, I'm going to do this as it relates to business and finances, that's fine. But I think he's only telling that to us to make sure our hearts are ready to be able to walk into that season, right? Because every prophetic word that God gives about the future is always conditional. I mean, look at your text. Read through so many of the prophetic words in the major and the minor prophets. It is always, if this, then I will. And that's not just negative things. That's positive things. I want to do this, but I'm going to require of you an internal composition to be able to handle that. The integrity of your heart will have to sustain the promises I want to bring on you, right? Like I've always, I'm a picture guy, and I've always seen this picture of the blessings and things that God wants to do stands only on shoulders of integrity of heart that can handle it. And he will not let you be crushed by the blessings he wants if your integrity can't handle it, right? And so he'll speak something futuristically to us about business, family, and things, but it's only so your heart can be prepared, because if your heart isn't prepared for it, I don't know that he always gives it to us, because if my heart isn't prepared for that thing, and he still gives it to me, that's actually a bad father, because no father gives their children gifts that's going to crush them. You only give it to them when they're ready for it. Hashtag Reagan, you ain't getting a cell phone. You ain't ready for it. So what I want us to hear is, in a time of chaos, the Lord is speaking, and it isn't to declare something. I think it's primarily to sit and wait inside of it and to let it be about our heart. Any thoughts, David, Dana, as we've talked about this?
You know, it's interesting, Pastor Joel, that you reference Psalm 139:18. And for those of you who are New Life members, you know that we just came out of this whole season, this whole prayer season called Wake Up. And in verse 18, it says, when I wake up, I am still with you. And that's really what I've been hearing the Lord saying, is that did God cause this? No, not necessarily, but we know that God is able to work together, right? He's able to cause these things to work together for our good. And I think one of the biggest blessings, if not the biggest blessing, is that we are with the Lord. And so when we've wakened up, when we've come to our senses, when we've seen that the things that we thought we needed, like, you know, we're looking at how little we can survive on. We thought we needed the hair salon and the nail salon. Bless the Lord. We do still need those things. However, we are able to realize that we really can. Maybe not you.
I don't need the hair salon.
Maybe not you. But we are able to realize that there's a lot less that we can live on. And so really, what is the most important thing is that we are with the Lord. And so that's really what God's been speaking in my heart, is come away with me. Be with me. That's what he wants. That's what he's always been calling us to.
Mm-hmm. I'm reminded of something that Pastor Jeremy said. He's preached this before, but times where he said it as well, is sometimes we're looking for someone to give us a prophetic word rather than going to the scriptures and reading the already written prophetic word that's in the scriptures. I think one thing that's going on with me right now is, Lord, I don't have the ability to meet with people in person. And I can meet with people online, but I feel like the Lord is calling me back to the word again and saying, get back into my scriptures, get back into what I've already written, and let that be a source of prophetic insight that I've already written in my word, and let that encourage you, let that build you up. I had the chance to go through the Psalms, and just reading one psalm a day, or when I got to Psalms 119, reading a portion of a psalm a day. You got to know Psalms 119 to understand that. But just reading that, getting that into my heart, and letting the Lord build up the prophetic word that he has for me through the scriptures, that on-time word, and being able to let the scriptures be that foundation. And even that foundation, sometimes it's the building blocks takes me higher and higher in his word. And I think Pastor Joel, that's one thing that sometimes we miss, is we're waiting to hear a word rather than to read the word that he's already given.
Well, yes, you didn't mean it this way, but how my brain interpreted what you just said is that there's this false binary, that there's the hearing the word and reading the word, and those are intertwined, right? Like they are the same. In fact, the scripture gives us the words to interpret the words that we hear, right? Like, sometimes I think the Lord downloads stuff to us and we can catch it. We don't know what he's saying because we don't know the word. Right. The word is the gift, because it is the translation key to what he's saying. In the context of prayer, these are the words that we use to pray. Right. In the context of worship, these are the words that we use. It would be like, let's pretend that Jesus speaks some unknown language that nobody ever knows. And this is the way he's going to talk to you. And he gives you a Jesus language to English translation. You just choose, I'm not going to use the Jesus language. How are you ever going to know what he says? You got to use that translation to match his word to English to understand what he's saying. Well, that's the same. The word is the filter by which we understand the prophetic. But in that same way, what you just described, my journey with the prophetic was I desired it. I and and not in a wrong way, but I wanted when I prayed with people, I didn't want to give like a generic thing, right? Like the Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you. The Lord loves you. Okay, yes, those are all absolutely true. But I wanted to be able to look at somebody and say, I see this going. What I soon found out is that was not the purpose that I was to grow in the prophetic. The purpose to grow in the prophetic was both for intimacy, and it also was through intimacy, right? Like intimacy with God was both the process and the byproduct. And we can talk about the prophetic in terms of gifting, and you can learn these techniques of how to hear God. That's true and fine. But I think that is losing the purpose of the prophetic. The purpose of the prophetic is to come closer to the one whom I'm already close with. It's the revelation for come up here, come up close to me, and then you're going to hear more things as you come close to me. And if intimacy, both in process and in product, byproduct, is not the purpose for our heart's desire for the prophetic, I don't think we ever really walk into a keenness of the prophetic. And the way we come close is by the word. We come close to the word. He then talks to us with his word, and then that draws us closer to him so that we've learned to hear his voice through the word, through our own intimate times. And then as we do the ministry stuff, then it flows out.
Yeah, and I feel like this is what the world is yearning for. I had a conversation with Pastor Joel. It may have been while this virus has just started to come out, and one thing that was strong in his heart was the world needs to hear a prophetic voice. It needs to hear what the Lord is saying. And I was getting caught up in everything else that was going on, all the different voices and news stories and all these different things that are coming up. And the world is just yearning. I was talking to, actually, a youth pastor. So not even just the world, but as a youth pastor from another church. And he was mentioning how he just feels helpless in this time. And I just began to... I heard him, and we had to get off the phone, and I've just been processing that, just that word, helpless, and this idea of needing to hear a word from the Lord, and needing to hear, but if we aren't in the word, Pastor Joel, it's going to be so hard to give a word. It's this idea of being able to go to scriptures and say, Lord, what are you saying? One of our pastors said a phrase. He said, what does hope look like now? This idea of what is the word saying to us, and how can we now go back to the world and say, this is a word for you. This is something the Lord is speaking to your heart. And I'm just in this place of saying, God, the world needs our voice. I need to know what you're saying so I can give them a word from you and to be able to encourage their hearts during this time.
Yeah, it reminds me of what Jesus said to his disciples when he said, I no longer call you servants, but friends. And that's what you were talking about, Pastor Joel, when you were saying that you desire this gift so that you could do ministry. And there are a lot of times that we get so focused on what does God want the people to know? And like you said, you know, we bypass God is speaking to us. So just like we don't share our secrets with just anybody, right? We share our secret parts of our heart with our friends. And so if you have a business, for example, you have employees that might work for you, you might tell them to do things, but you're not going to be telling them secrets of your heart. Whereas Jesus is saying, I don't want you just to be my servants, but I want you to be my friends. And so when you're my friends, you're going to come close to me. You're going to spend time with me naturally, because that's what friends do. And so in that relationship, I'm going to begin to tell you my heart. And then as we begin to hear the heart of our friend for ourselves, that then overflows to other conversations that we have with our friends. So the prophetic doesn't become this weird thing that we have to drum up. It's just like if you and I were having a conversation and I'm like, you know, I really feel like the Lord is saying, I'm going to share that with you because you're my friend, but I've heard it first from my friend Jesus. And I feel that, you know, as we're talking about people who are online or people who are, you know, wanting to know, this is what the Lord is saying to the nations. It's really not about that. It's about us spending time coming back again to the heart of our Father and saying, God, we love you, and we're receiving this invitation that you're giving us to draw near to you. And as we draw near to him, he draws near to us, and he shows us his heart.
Yeah. I want to, in our last few moments, I want to ask you guys some questions. And if I'm kind of watching the feed here, so if you've got some questions and things, you can post that in there or some comments as it relates to this. I want to talk about three hindrances that I think come to our ability to hear. And the first is, in general, I'm not aware of how he speaks to me. Right? Like, I think the one thing that we do is we see somebody operate in one kind of way, and we assume that that's the only way, right? The God who created everything, that all creatives flow from the Creator, that he can only create one way that he talks to people, right? And one of the hindrances is we've not developed a history with God, a prophetic history with God, that we understand how he talks to us. And so, Pastor Dana, would you just share a little bit, maybe your own journey, as to how you developed and how you developed hearing, how or understanding or uncovering, whatever word you want to use, discovering how God talks to you?
Yeah, I think it starts with my motives. So I have to search my heart and say, God, I want to hear you speak. I want to know what you're saying. Like, I am so close to the Lord. I literally imagine him as my best friend. And so I want to know, what are you saying, God? What are you doing? And so then I have to quiet myself. I have to take away the distractions. You know, for me, it's very, very quiet in my house. So the kids are away, TV's away. You know, I have to get very quiet. And then I just listen. And I am a dreamer. So God does oftentimes speak to me through dreams, but God speaks to me through nature a lot of times. If I'm at the beach, if I'm taking a walk outside, if I'm looking at plants or flowers, I mean, God is always speaking to me through living things. And so I'll get a picture of something if I'm out for a walk, and I'm like, oh, that is so God. God also speaks to me often through my children, and that's, I think, a special gift because, you know, he is a father, and oftentimes, God will say, Dana, you're a mom. You know what that father heart, that parent heart is for your kids. And so this is what I want for my kids. And so oftentimes, my kids will do something and they'll say something. And I'm like, oh, my Lord, this is you, Lord. Like,
okay,
you're speaking to me.
So right there, so your kid does something. Mm-hmm. And it's the Lord talking to you through your kid. Mm-hmm. Walk me through practically. Is that, how do you know that's God? Something. Do you get hot inside? Do you hear a voice external to you? Do you hear a thought in your head? Like, how do you know that that's the Lord?
All right, so this is a story I love to tell. So there was one day I was being real just irritable with my kids. I know you guys can't believe that, but I was just, you know, yelling at the kids. I was just having a bad day. And so I went upstairs in my bathroom, and I'm, like, doing my makeup or something, and I'm just, like, beating myself up. Like, oh, I can't believe I lost it with the kids again. God, I know that, you know, I told you I'm going to work on this, and here I am making these mistakes again. And then I hear the sound come out of my bedroom, and it was like a crashing sound. And so I was like, what is that? So I go in the room, I'm looking around, nothing's out of order except for this picture frame that was out of place. So I pick up the picture frame, and it was a picture frame that my youngest, Colin, had made for me when he was about 6 years old. And it's just a picture of him. I always get like teary-eyed when I say this, but it was a picture of him, and he was holding up this sign that said, you are good. And it was the Lord speaking to me through that picture frame that Colin had made years prior. And that was God just reminding me that, yes, you've messed up. Yes, you've missed the mark yet again, but you are good. You're mine. And so it's those little things that God will use oftentimes to just speak his word to me to encourage my heart.
Pastor David, how about you? How have you seen this grow in you of learning how he talks to you specifically?
Sure. So many of you know my affinity and love for music, and my mother is a orchestra teacher for years, and so we've grown up in a very musical household. These last year or so, I have three little girls at my house, and so I'm doing breakfast oftentimes. When I wake up in the morning, I will have a song that will be playing in my head. And so while I'm feeding the kids breakfast, especially during this time of being quarantined, I'll put a song on. And that song, while we're having breakfast time, will be something that speaks to my heart, a lyric, a phrase from a song. This Is a Move by Tasha Cobbs has been like reverberating in my heart. And there's this part of where she begins to prophesy, singing, and she begins to prophesy how healing is coming into the room and deliverance is coming into the room. And it just, it's something in my heart. It's like a, it's really hard to explain, but it's like something in my heart just kind of shifts from being sad to happy, or something in me just kind of, it just, something clicks in my head, and something in, down in my knower just begins to affirm that those lyrics or those songs. And so I encourage folks to find a song that you can play off of YouTube, find a song that you can play off of Spotify. It needs to be the same song. It could be a song we sang on Sunday, but find a song that you can sing. And I've oftentimes, the Lord has spoken to me through the lyrics, so I haven't had to make up my own words. The words coming through the music have become the words that I can hold on to during the week.
One of the things that I've learned, to your part about scripture and the word is, so I see things and I feel things, drives my wife crazy. Hashtag I'm a feeler. And I can't tell you why something, I can't tell you exactly what it is, but I feel something and I'm like, I don't feel good. I feel uncomfortable. I feel, whatever. And sometimes I just know that I feel that way, and other times I physically can feel that way. And I have learned to discern that's Holy Spirit, not through a picture or a dream, but that's Holy Spirit through a feeling, saying something is off in you. You're feeling anxious. You're feeling worried. You feel anger in you. But I'm like, I ain't angry. You're like, no. You got some in you, right? Like, and so those feelings, and sometimes it's not even emotional feelings. Sometimes it's, I'll be walking down a hallway, and all of a sudden, I'll feel unsure about something, or be like, "No, I gotta go over here." I don't exactly know why, but I've learned the difference of my feeling and that feeling. And the other thing I learned, particularly from my wife, though, of how we hear God speak, is my wife doesn't always see pictures, but she'll get a Bible verse. I mean, like a Bible verse I didn't know existed. Like the third book of Isaiah.
That one actually doesn't exist.
Okay, fair enough. But she'll get some kind of random verse, and when that random verse emerges, that wasn't just because she had bad pizza. That was because Holy Spirit illuminated that verse in her, and if we're not careful, we'll just bypass that verse, like, oh, that was weird. I thought about that verse today. I never thought about that verse in 5 months or 5 years. But as my wife will then go to a point of meditation on that verse, the Lord begins to speak to her and through her through that prompting of that singular verse. And so don't, if you're at home and you're watching and listening, if either a song or a feeling or a picture or a particular verse emerges, don't just assume that's random. That's Holy Spirit illuminating something. And as I've learned how he speaks to me, I've leaned into that. I found that he speaks more. Okay, so that's the first thing. We've got to learn how he speaks. The second thing is I got to believe that he will speak to me. So sometimes I feel like that should be first, but I'm not sure that's true. Because if you grew up in a charismatic environment, you saw the gifts happening, and you could say, okay, I recognize that he can speak these different ways, but I'm just not sure he just wants to talk to me. If you don't believe he wants to talk to you, I'm not sure how much you're going to really hear the prophetic to you at all, right? And so have you guys, either one of you, battled the sense of he wants to talk to them, and he should talk to them, but I don't know if he wants to talk to little old me.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I for sure did. I grew up in a Baptist tradition, and so we were not necessarily acquainted with all of the moves of the Holy Spirit. And so when I came to New Life, I have to be honest that I was very uncomfortable with the prophetic because I had never really seen it exemplified in a way that felt normal to me. It always felt a little creepy. And so I remember the first time I was asked to be a part of the, what we used to call the prophetic press threes, yes. And so I was like, oh my gosh, I cannot do this. You know, what if somebody sits by me and they, you know, they want a word from the Lord and I got nothing, right? And so, man, I have never fasted and prayed so much in my life. You know, I was like, God, please, please do not leave me out there. I'm like, okay, let me just pray some, you know, crazy prayer over you. But it is in my weakness that that Christ is strong, right? It's in all of our weakness. And so for me, like Paul said, I boast in my weakness so that I can glory in his strength. And so I remember several times of now doing this for years of sitting with people and hearing what the Lord has to say to them. And I'm going to tell you something that's so interesting is that usually when I prophesy very specifically to someone, I won't remember everything that I said, but that person will remember. They're like, oh, they'll find me at church, you know, years later. Oh, do you remember when you told me this and this? And I'm like, I'm sorry, who are you? Have we met? Because I won't remember. And so those moments, and those are more the rare moments. That's not necessarily how God prophesies all the time. But that fear, that trepidation of not necessarily I don't want God to speak to me, but will he? Like, am I qualified? Am I a, quote, prophet, right? And I think sometimes we get the office of the prophet confused with the gift of prophecy, that God does desire to speak to us whether you consider yourself a prophet or not.
Yeah. Yeah, I went through a season where I felt like God was done using me. This was before I got on staff here at New Life, and I went through this season where I told myself I'm just going to be just a regular Christian. I'm not going to be, you know, a Christian that's going to be used by God. I had it all mixed up, but I was because of failures that were happening in my past, and so I was walking in those failures and not understanding that the blood of Jesus covered every sin that I've confessed to Him, and I was made new in Christ, but I was walking in such shame that I didn't believe that God could speak to me. And there were these moments where he would break through the shame and I would end up, you know, speaking to somebody and they'd be like, oh, that was wonderful. And I was like, I don't even know how that happened because God don't speak to me, you know. And I had to get out of this phase and even, and I'm kind of going through a season now where I'm starting to not just believe, but even walk in faith a little bit more in knowing that God wants to use me. Not that he speaks to me, but he actually wants to use me. He wants to bring things out of me. He wants to use me to help other people. And I had to really, I don't know, Pastor Joel, I know some of your testimony, some of your story, but I had to let go of that shame. I had to let go of that shame. It's the idea that I need to be good for him to speak to me. I needed to be good for him to speak through me. I needed to, and this idea that I'm his son. I talk to my daughters whether they're good or whether they're not good because they're my daughters. And even, you know, I have a 3-year-old who is all three, and she's just lovely and wonderful. And there's times that she doesn't want to talk to me because she has an attitude, and I have to stop her and I say, no, you're my daughter. We have to talk. This idea that God wants to speak to me, he wants to tell me his secrets because we're friends. And this idea of the relationship, my relationship with God, I'm so grateful that he pursued me in this way to say, I want to have something to say to you.
I think that's one of the things I'm so appreciative of Pastor Dan and Kevin as we talked about. They've modeled for us what a house of grace looks like. That if you are adding anything to the death and resurrection of Jesus, you're outside of the line of gospel. Right, like you have the right, you're justified for him to speak to you simply because of what Christ did in you and him, and you don't have to add anything else. And sometimes I think we get in this mindset that I have to be good enough. I haven't fasted enough. I start and stop a fast literally every single day, and we get in a space where I have to perform in order to hear. Or I have to perform in order to get him to want to speak to me. He just wants you. And if I can push on your words for just a minute, and we don't have time to discuss this, but I'm not a tool. I just spit on you. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I'm a son. And he's not interested in using me. He used a donkey for Balaam, right? He talks about rocks crying out. Like, he's not interested. He doesn't have a business where he needs employees. He has a business where he needs sons and daughters to work with him, not for him.
Right.
And for me, if I think the prophetic is about him using me, I think I've got this out of order, because he's just going to give me commands. Hey, go say this, but don't understand why, or I'm apart from what he's trying to do. I'm a son. I'm in the family business. He and I are working together, and because of that, he wants to speak to me. Nothing I can do or can't do can change that. And if I can live in that space, then I really believe he wants me, and I'll just keep coming to the place where he talks to me, and I know that I can't forfeit that thing. Like, I can't screw that up, because he's the dad. He wants to talk to his kids, and we together are going to partner in what he's saying to me, change me, so that when I talk to you, I'm speaking out of a place of transformation and desire. Because ultimately, we just reproduce who we are. So for a bunch of performance-based workers who believe they got to earn the right for God to talk to us, then that thing that then I declare to you, a prophetic word, is going to be seated in the word that I give to you. And it's going to produce a performance-based reality for that word that I think I'm giving to you actually could harm you more than help you, because then you got to work to get to that word rather than coming out of a place of joined with God. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Any thoughts on that?
I do think we have a responsibility to steward well what God has given us, right? And this word responsibility, I was thinking about this last night when I was reading, and I was thinking about, you know, our responsibility is really our response to God's ability. It isn't that we have to somehow drum up something new, or that we have to come up with a word to say, but it's what do we really feel like God is able to do, right? Like, do we really believe that God is able to stop this virus? Do we really believe that, or do we just say that? Do we really believe that God is able to work all things together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose? Do we really believe that God wants to fill our hearts with hope? Do we really believe that God wants us to increase our faith in this season? Like, what do we really believe? And so when we think of what are God's abilities, our response to his abilities become our responsibility. And so when we're able to share the love of Christ with someone, I no longer look at it as a duty, like, oh my goodness, I've got to, you know, witness to five people this week, but it's like, no, this is my responsibility. And I oftentimes say it's my privilege and my responsibility. Yeah. It's our privilege to be able to hear from God and to be able to share God's heart with somebody else. It's our responsibility, but it's also our privilege to do that.
As we finish, let me just give, I think, the last hindrance. So the first was, I'm not aware how he talks to me. The second is, I don't believe that he will or wants to. The third one is, I just haven't done the last thing. Like, I'm convinced of this. Like, okay, so I got my son, right? My oldest son, my wife and I lovingly call him a bit of a helium balloon. Like, he just kind of floats. And sometimes he wants the second thing, but he hasn't done the first thing. Mm-hmm. I'm like, no. Let's back this train up. Let's do the first thing, and then we can talk about the second thing. And sometimes the Lord speaks something to us about you, about your heart. And I don't always want to admit that. And I want to hear a second thing. And then he gets real quiet. It isn't actually because he's quiet. It's because he just keeps talking about the first thing. And I have just learned with God, go back to the last thing and ask myself, did I do it? Have I engaged you in it? You talked about my impatience. You talked about my pride. You talked about the way I love my wife and my kids. You ain't got to talk to me about other things because I hadn't engaged you in this thing. Now, it doesn't always mean that thing with us gets solved in a moment, right? Some of these things, man, he has spoken to me about pride and ambition, and like something happened to me like 3 months ago. It's 10 years ago, right? My story with my broken leg and things all aligned with that. And I'm like, Jesus, haven't we got far enough? Haven't we gained enough wins in that? And so it isn't like it gets solved, but I'm willing to engage him in it. And when I'm willing to engage him in it, that opens the door for the next thing. And I hear people say sometimes, he ain't talking to me. And I want to be like, well, have you done the last thing? Have you engaged the last thing? You engage the last thing, that'll open the door for the next thing.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So maybe if you're at home, can I encourage you? What's the last thing that he said? Mm-hmm. If you feel like you're in a season of not hearing, do you believe that he wants to? Mm-hmm. And maybe right now your prayer is, Lord, help me know that you want to. Have you uncovered how he talks to you? Maybe for you, your prayer is, Lord, show me how you speak to me. or for those of you who are at a space where you know how he talks and you know that he wants to, but you've left the last thing that he's done and you're in a bit of a wilderness time of hearing, go back to the last thing and ask him, Lord, have I engaged you in it?
You know, Pastor Joel, that's so good. A lot of times when people come and ask me for some sort of they're saying like the voice of the Lord is silent right now, and they're in some sort of distress or worry. Yeah. Oftentimes I'll ask them, what was the last thing? Not the last thing he told you to do, but what was the last thing he said to you?
That's good.
And oftentimes they'll say, the last thing I've heard is that he loves me. Mm. Or the last thing that I heard that he cares about me. Or the last thing I've heard that everything is okay. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes I'll be able to say, that word is still present. Mm-hmm. The word is still true. Repeat that over your own heart.
So good,
repeat that over your own self. His word is still true. It hasn't gone away. Mm-hmm. And you can hold on to that word. I just want to read a scripture real quick, if that's okay. In Isaiah 55, verse 8, and it says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the, I love this verse in Isaiah 55, verse 10, it says, for as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty. I don't know who needs to hear that. It shall not, his word will not return empty. It will accomplish that which I purpose and will succeed in the thing for which I sent it. For you shall go forth in joy and be led forth in peace. May that word just permeate your heart and your mind. Accept the promise that whatever you're going through right now, you're going to be led forth in joy. You're going to go out in joy and be led forth in peace.
Pastor Dana, would you pray for us here in our congregation watching online that they would be blessed with the season of hearing God?
Absolutely. Father, we just thank you. God, we thank you that you are a God who desires for us to know your heart. Father, we thank you that you are a God who wants to speak to us, God, and you want us to hear you clearly. Lord, you are not hiding yourself from us. As a matter of fact, God, you said that when we seek you with all of our hearts, that you will be found by us. And so, Lord, today we posture ourselves, Lord, in the position of seeking you. Father, the things that we have allowed to cloud our understanding of you, to stop our ears, God, would you reveal those things to us, whether they be distractions or disobedience or some sort of besetting sin, Lord, whatever it is, God, that's blocking the flow, would you, Lord, reveal that to us so that we can make that right with you? God, we say we want to hear you. We want to see you, God. We want to know what you're doing. And God, we want to be your friend. Father, we thank you. Through Jesus, you have offered friendship to yourself. What a gift. Father, I pray that we would remember that it is our responsibility to steward your words well. That even as Pastor David said, Lord, your words, they have a purpose. They're not void, Lord. When you speak, God, you desire for your words to accomplish something. And so, Father, would you attune our ears to be able to hear what you're saying? Lord, I specifically lift up that person right now who feels like they're not worthy of hearing you speak to them. Maybe they've made so many mistakes. Father, I speak to that person who maybe they feel like they've never heard you speak. They've tried before and they've still come up empty. God, would today be a turning for them? Would today be the day, oh God, that they hear your word? Lord, we know that the words that you speak to us ultimately line up with your written word. And so, God, we just rebuke the enemy who would come and try to deceive us. Lord, your word says that he is an angel of light. He tries to pretend like he's an angel of light. And so, God, we just ask, oh, Lord, that there will be no deception, that there will be no confusion, no uncertainty, Father, that when you speak, that we would know it, that there would be something in our spirit that would resonate with your words. And then, God, give us the grace to obey you. Because we don't just want to hear you, God. We don't just want to be hearers of the word, but we want to be doers also. So give us the grace to obey you when you speak. Father, give us opportunities that we can share what you're saying to us with other people. And let it be normal and natural. God, let it be God-breathed. We love you. We receive this grace today to hear you speak. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Church, thank you for joining with us. Reminder, we have this midday every day at noon. We've got a whole lineup of Equip classes that just launched yesterday, Monday through Friday, 2 o'clock classes, 7 o'clock classes. You can go on the website, newlife.global. You can click the Equip classes, and you can sign up for them. They're all through Zoom. Consider joining one of those 8. God bless you. Have a great day.